Well, it's Friday the 25th of September. The space weather is getting choppy. We are all in these seas for the duration. I'm either strapped to a mast yelling at the storm, or a bottle cast into rough seas with a destination in mind. It depends on the day. This is episode 2038 of 301 Permanently Moved Online, a personal podcast 301 seconds in length, written, recorded and edited by me at the JMO. It'll be October next time we speak, and St Thérèse of Lisieux's feast day will have passed. In recognition of ancestors, I'll begin with her parents, Saints Louis Matin and Zéel Gourin, whose saint's day happened to be today. Louis Matin was a watchmaker and his wife Zéel a lace maker. Together, they are the first, and today only, married couple to be canonized in the Catholic tradition. Married in 1858, they intended to live a life of celibacy. However, they consummated their marriage 10 months later after encouragement from their spiritual director. They went on to have 9 children, 4 of whom died in infancy. The remaining 5, all girls, became nuns. The youngest was St. Thérèse of the Child Jesus and Holy Face. Born January 2nd, 1873, died September 30, 1897, at the age of 24. Her saint's day is October the 1st. As you can imagine, she was raised in a very Catholic environment. Her family attended Mass at 5:30 a.m. daily and observed the rhythm of the liturgical year with its feasts and fasts and prayers. In 1877, at 4 and a half, her mother died of breast cancer. She would later write, "Every detail of my mother's illness is still with me, especially her last weeks on earth. The first part of my life stopped that day." Her father moved the family to Lisieux months later. At the age of 9, her sister Marie Pauline entered the monastery at Lisieux, and she was devastated. 15 years her senior, her sister had become a second mother to her. The shock of the departure reawakened the trauma of her mother's death, and she began suffering tremors and neurotic attacks. Cured after she had turned to gaze at the statue of the Virgin Mary in her bedroom, who smiled back at her. She wrote in a letter, aged 10, about the experience. "Our Blessed Lady has come to me. She has smiled upon me. How happy I am." On Christmas Eve of that year, she then experienced what she called a complete conversion. After 9 years of sorrow at the death of her mother, she wrote that Jesus accomplished the work I had not been able to do. The following spring, her father suffered a catastrophic stroke, and during his recovery, Thérèse announced her intention to take up the habit and join the monastery. It would take another 2 years of fervent prayer and an audience with the Pope in Rome before being admitted to the Carmelite Order in 1888, at the age of 15, an order reformed in the 16th century by St. Teresa of Avila. Her days from then on were devoted to silent labour and personal and collective prayer. Her time as a postulant taught her that in religious life, no sacrifice would astonish her. She learnt that to deviate from routine resulted in the mind wandering in arid lands where the water of grace is soon lacking. 1 year later, she took the habit and was given the epithet of the Child Jesus. She fell into the life of retreat and subtraction. In her work, she returns repeatedly to the theme of littleness and simplicity, referring to herself as a grain of sand. Her early 20s were influenced heavily by the writings of the mystic St. John of the Cross. She wrote that she had no other spiritual nourishment. It was during this time that she began contemplating depictions of the disfigured face of Jesus during the Passion and gained her second name of the Holy Face. After 5 years of spiritual work, she was appointed prioress novice mistress by her sister, who by this time was mother of the convent. She excelled at explaining spiritual doctrine to younger novitiates using new technology. The three mirrors of a kaleidoscope clarified the Holy Trinity. The elevator describes God's grace, and the steam train illustrates Christ as Logos. It was through teaching these concepts she saw the limitations of her efforts and began adding the words very little, tout petit, in front of her name. Then, June 9th, 1895, at the age of 22, during Mass, Thérèse was struck with inspiration that she should offer herself as sacrificial victim to God's merciful love. After the service, she wrote what is now known as the Act of Oblation to Merciful Love, and performed the ritual in her cell with her sister. It's one hell of a document, though I personally wouldn't perform it. "In the evening of this life, I shall appear before you with empty hands. Lord, I do not ask you count my works." 2 years later, she was dead from tuberculosis. In these final years, she wrote The Story of a Soul from her bed, an autobiography containing diary entries, spiritual commentary, prayers, and poetry. I read it earlier this year during the beginning of the UK lockdown. I emerged from both the book and my years-long depression at the same time. The prayer to obtain humility struck me like a lightning rod. Each morning I resolve to be humble, and in the evening I recognise that I have often been guilty of pride, and asking to send humiliation whenever I try to set myself above others. Other poems, like To Scatter Flowers or I Thirst for Love, are alive and electric in their words. If you feel like a bottle tossed about by the ocean right now, Maybe this is a book for you, too.